Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Today, we're going to continue our look at whole muscle dry cured meat. So in the fridge, I have a capocollo going. It is still in the initial stages of the curing process in the fridge. And it got me thinking, I really love those flavors on the pork neck. Could I find a piece of beef, apply the same flavors to it, and see what happens? So I was at the grocery store, and they had a whole bunker filled with Packer beef tenderloins. Super cheap and probably not top grade, but it's gonna do what it needs to do in this application. So pretty much all we really need to worry about is the weight of the piece of meat, and then everything else is expressed as a percentage of that. And the first two things that we need are salt and cure number two. And so this is, just like I do with all of my dry cured stuff, this is a measured dry cure or an equilibrium dry cure, where I make sure that the amount of salt that I'm putting in here isn't going to make this too salty. It's just the right amount of salt to do both the curing process and to keep it from being too salty. It sort of walks that line. There are other processes where you just throw all kinds of salt at it, let it sit in all kinds of salt, rinse some of the salt off. Sometimes you're soaking some of the salt out because you know that there's too much salt. And I just, why bother? Why not just start out right at the very beginning? So to this, I'm going to add garlic powder, ground black pepper, and some ground clove. And in this spice grinder, I'm going to put some dry red chili flakes, some dry rosemary leaves, and I've got some bay leaves, and I just want to crush those up a little bit before I put them in. There we go. Okay, that should be good. Now, I'm going to mix this all together. Let's give that a good mix, and we need to rub this all over the piece of meat, and we need to use the entire amount of cure. So, rub it in, and anywhere that there's a little cut or a break, you want to make sure that you get it all inside there. Get every little piece coated. I'm going to use a vacuum sealer for the first part of the cure. So I'm going to slip this in. You could use Ziploc bags if that's what you have. Just make sure you get all of that in there. Don't waste any of that cure. Okay, so I'm going to write on this package what it is and the date. Very important part of the process, just so that if it ends up in the fridge, you don't forget when you put it in there or what it was, especially since I've got four or five other things in there on the go. So this piece of meat isn't very big. It probably would cure in 3-4 days. I'm going to leave it at least a week, and every day I'm going to take it out and I'm going to massage it, I'm going to flip it over, and I'm going to put it back in. I really want the flavors to develop, and because we're using an equilibrium dry cure, it won't get over salty. So I could leave this in the fridge. If I'm unable to get on to the next part of the cure, I could leave it in there for probably 2 weeks, and it would be safe. We've used the Insta-Cure number 2, which is going to keep it completely safe. We've used enough salt, which will keep it completely safe. So time is on my side if I get too busy. But hopefully I'll see you back here in a week. A week has gone by and this is cured, so I need to get it out of the package and rinse it off. Whole lot of hand washing going on today. Now the purpose of that rinse is just to get rid of the excess spices on the outside. The idea is that those spices have done their job and we don't need them anymore. That's the idea. I'm kind of someone who thinks maybe I'm going to leave them on at some point and see if that really changes it. But now you can put on fresh spices to bring a little bit more flavor during the next step of the process. And I wasn't trying to get rid of any salt there, and I'm not really all that worried if there are spices still on the outside of this piece of meat. Not a huge deal. So this is just black pepper. And I'm going to coat the outside. And this is really just coat the outside. Don't have to weigh it. You don't have to really worry too much about it. Put as much pepper on it as you like. And if you really like black pepper, you can load it on. Now, this is a beef cap, or at least that's what I ordered. I called up a supplier in Vancouver that I normally deal with for this sort of thing and said, I'm looking for a beef bung. The guy on the phone said, you're probably looking for a beef cap, which is part of the same part of the digestive tract of a cow. Not knowing the difference, I said, okay, fine, I'll get beef cap. So this is what I got. And it comes salted, and you have to soak it and rinse it and soak it and rinse it. So this was in a sink of cold water for about an hour and a half, and I changed the water a couple of times. And after about an hour and a half, it was pliable enough that I could open it up at this end and start running water through it, or filling it with water and then dumping the water out. You can't run water through it because it's closed at this end. Cows have a very strange digestive tract. So what I need to do is get this into the beef cap, which shouldn't be that difficult. The cap is far too long for the piece of meat that I have, far too big. So I will tie it off here and I'll rinse this out and use it for another piece of charcuterie. So this is my first time and I'm not sure the best way to go about this. So I might just tie a knot here at the end. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tie a knot with string. So I cut off the other part of the beef cap, tied it again with a bubble knot, which means you just fold over the flap and then tie it shut so no air can get in or out. So no air can get in. Doesn't matter if it gets out. Next thing is I want to poke it to let the air out. You don't want to trap any air inside this piece of beef cap. So there are little pokey things that do this job. I have one. I can't find it. So I'm just using whatever I have on hand. I've got some jet net. I want to see if I can slip this jet net over it just to compact it, control it, and then we're going to try and tie it. So there's a little contraption that would make this so much easier that I don't have because I didn't have the money to buy four or five different sizes. So I'm just going to struggle with it. I'll get the jet net on and it will work out fine. A little bit of a struggle. I got there in the end. Now I need to tie it with butcher twine. Also to help it keep its shape, but also to give me a way to hang it up in the dry ager. And this might not be pretty, so don't look too closely. So this was the open end where I stuffed it through and I tied it off. So I just tied another knot there and you make a loop and you bring it over. And you tighten it, and then you make a loop, and you bring it over, and you go a few inches farther along, and then you tighten it again, and try to get the tightening spots kind of in a row. It's tough. I will get better over time, and so will you. Now, I write a label with what it is. Date and the weight, the starting weight. Now that it's tied up, it's got a tag with the date and the weight. Let's take it down to the dry ager. Now I've got this dry ager set up on a cycle that is specifically for dry curing charcuterie, which is different than the cycle for dry aging meat. I've also got the temperature set to 12.5 degrees Celsius and 80% humidity. Although it's a little bit different right now because I've been opening and closing the door all day. So I'm gonna hang this in here. I'm gonna make sure that it's not touching anything else. And I'm gonna keep checking on the weight. When it loses 30% of its weight, I'm gonna pull it out. Now, this one has been hanging in the dry aged or in the basement for about 3 weeks, and I've got really good mold coverage on the outside. For some of the ones I've done, I got good mold coverage, and others I didn't really. I don't know what the difference is. So now we have to, as you've watched any of the ones in the past, I have to cut off the jet net, the tying, and the casing underneath. So just carefully get in there, cut away as much as you can. The jet net can be a little bit difficult. The casing comes off relatively easy once you get up under one part and then you just pull it off. And don't get freaked out by the mold. I know that a lot of people get really freaked out by the mold. It's harmless, completely harmless. It actually protects the meat from more harmful bacteria. So, there we go. Got the casing off. Let's cut in and see what it looks like. Okay. Slice in and let's take a look at color. Fantastic color. Hey, Jules.
Hey, Glen. Hey, friends.
So this is Beef Tenderloin, and I've dry cured it using the same spices I used on the Capocollo that is still hanging down in the dry ager.
Okay.
So, very mild.
Mm-hmm. It would be a mild.
Really mild, but the flavor, it has that Capocollo flavor to it, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It could just be a little punchier.
Well, I just have to put some pickle with it.
First attempt, I think it works really well. And so the flavors go really well with the beef. Mm-hmm. Anyway. So I could maybe double up
on the spicing.
Interesting. I like this. The things you can do at home. So just play with your flavors. That's all I can say. I think I really like this. This is going to go well on a sandwich. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.